Welcome aboard the BK Escape Pod. That's right, it's the augmented and bionic podcast version of the live show you can hear Saturdays from 10 a.m. till 12 p.m. Eastern on 100.3 FM and AM 1450 WBHF Radio. You can stream the show live there Saturdays at WBHFradio.org or on the free TuneIn app. Look out, here we go.
This is a rebroadcast of BK on the Air. If you hear a telephone number, please don't call, as you will become one with the dark side of the Force.
Stand by to receive our transmission.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Hey, welcome everybody to BK on the Air. I am obviously not, you can tell by the tone of my voice, this is not the baritone voice of one Barry White King. No, it is not BK. It is me, Alan Sanders. And Brian Gwynn, who's been with us a few times before, is joining me as well. He's filling in for me so I can fill in for BK. It's weird how this works. It's promotion by, I guess, substitution.
Exactly. And I usually come in and I'm just the laugh track with the both of them, so I don't know who's filling in for me, so no, y'all just laugh.
Yeah, well, Walt should be here for that, but that's right. Walt's on a cruise. He's on his ninth honeymoon vacation.
Oh,
you know.
That's awesome.
We were texting last night, and I said, Walt Into Darkness, by the way, he's been on the show multiple times. He's my podcast partner. They just got back from a cruise, but we were chatting on the phone yesterday, or texting back and forth. I say chat when I mean text. But we were texting, and he goes, yeah, this is like our fourth or fifth honeymoon. I'm like, dude, it's been over 9 months. You've had a kid in the time you've been on your honeymoon. He didn't respond, so I don't know if I upset him or not. I can't tell. Sometimes I can't tell with text. I'm like, it's funny to me. And then, like, no response. I'm like,
Did I offend? Oh, gee, how do I back?
Well, we do live in a time where you're probably, if you're going to air, you'll probably be offending somebody without even thinking about
exactly.
It.
Exactly. Do you still use punctuation when you text?
I do.
You know.
Have you heard about that?
Yeah, you know the age of whoever's texting you by the use of punctuation or something?
My kids told, okay, this is something we talked about with BK a long time ago, but I'm going to bring it up since you brought it up.
Okay.
Because I didn't know if you heard it before.
I missed a show.
You didn't see, you don't listen to every show?
Wow.
You're not a loyal fan? Wow, what kind of a, and you're in here.
I don't have my card, that's right, okay.
No, my girls, which by the way, they're in their mid-20s now, they're out. They're out of college, they got jobs, they're, like, they actually are success stories, they never came back, which is good.
Right.
They said, you know, we just know you don't mean it, but when you put punctuation, we assume you're yelling at us. I went, What? They go, well, nobody puts full sentences first off. But
right.
Second, nobody punctuates. We know what you mean, so just get to it. And if you're going full sentences, it sounds like a lecture.
Yeah.
And so that must mean you're upset or you're yelling at us. I was like, by writing grammatically correct sentences.
Wouldn't that happen?
It's bananas.
Yeah.
And it gets worse because my youngest daughter is the worst because she's the youngest. So
right.
she never knew a time without a cell phone, never knew a time without a tablet
exactly.
or social media.
Yep.
My other girls had to slowly get into it. Hey, weather-wise, Brian, fall came in perfectly.
Oh, this is beautiful. This is absolutely beautiful. I'm done with the 90s, done with the 80s. I want 70s and below, 60s and below.
Yeah.
That's where I live.
And BK and I talked about our favorite season, so we'll pull you in from a couple of weeks back. If you had to rank your seasons, what's your favorite?
Oh, fall, winter.
Fall, winter.
I could live in Alaska.
That's me. Fall, winter, then spring, then summer's last.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Look
yeah.
at you.
I'd rather
you and I are like two peas in a pod, separated by time, distance, and a different mom.
Just lock the door next Saturday when Barry comes back, and we'll just take over the show.
Well, he's not back next Saturday.
All right.
I'm here two Saturdays in a row.
I got to work, I think, but maybe I can work from here. I can work in the next room and just pop in for 2 hours.
All right, so when we last left, we were learning that writing full sentences in text is frowned upon by the Gen Zers.
Yeah, then I need a dictionary for all the abbreviations that they have. I don't even know what daughter's saying half the time. So
I make fun of my kid, and then I find out she's actually making more fun of me using
right.
words. I'm like, is that a put down? And she's like, if you don't know, then don't worry
yeah,
about it.
Yeah. Okay, when I'm texting her that my ADD is really bad, I actually put A, capital A, dot, capital D, dot, capital, and it takes forever to do it. But it's like, she would know if I just put ADD, but I don't know.
I will tell you this, though. I I've had counselors in here, like college counselors, people like how to apply for college. And they said one of the biggest things they're dealing with is supposedly educated kids applying, and they don't know how to write an actual essay anymore because they're writing in tech speak.
Oh, wow.
And whether you like it or not, Gen Zers, the people who are making the decisions over who's going to come to their university are not Gen Zers. Mm. They are adults who live in an adult world who understand grammar. And if you can't write an essay, they're not going to take you.
Do they write like LOL and IDK on their essays that they have?
Won't capitalize pronouns.
Really?
Wow. Yeah. Well, I don't know. Do we still have pronouns?
I don't know.
No, pronouns. Proper nouns.
I don't know. It's the commas. I'm still stuck on commas. I don't know. What
you know, I wanted to be an English major in college, which I was a minor because I couldn't get my foreign language credits where I needed them. I couldn't get it. I was like, this is terrible. I've learned all this literature. I've learned all of this stuff. I've taken more than enough classes, but because I couldn't pass the foreign language requirement, I've never understood that.
Yeah.
I want my English degree. Okay, go speak another language. Wait,
why? Okay, well, nowadays, it's like, you know, yeah, everywhere you go, it's like so many good languages. Everybody's knowing different things. It's like Blade Runner. Mm-hmm. I love it. You know, maybe nice and mix and match, and I kind of regret not knowing another language.
I agree.
Yeah.
My what's crazy about this, though, so I took French because my mom is French-Canadian.
Oh, okay.
She never spoke French to me growing up.
Right.
After 2 years, which I was able to handle French 1 and French 2, but they said, no, you got to take 3 and 4 as well. I'm like, what? So I got into French 3, and the only class I ever had to withdraw in my entire college career was French 3 because I had a D 3 weeks in.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, this is not going to get better.
No. No.
And so I had to say I'm done. So I settled for a minor.
I took Spanish 1 twice, so there you go.
But I had to get a major in psychology, which is what my main degree is.
Well,
okay. So I'm still trying to figure BK out. We got to take a break. We'll be back with more of BK on the Air. We've got a golden rage of TV coming up.
And now this message.
Time is money. Using time effectively means added profits and improved business efficiency. That's where Westside Communications can help. A Westside beeper can keep you in touch for important calls and messages. All over town, in the privacy of your own daily schedule. No itineraries, no more tracking you down. One phone call puts you in touch. A Westside beeper is a time and space expander. It can work for you today, saving time, improving service. Call Westside Communications now. Tell them Leonard Nimoy gave you the message.
Give it up!
Podcast Magazine presents 50 Countdown.
Hi, it's Rob Actis, host of the podcast magazine Hot 50 Countdown. Join me as I count them down from 50 to number one, the top 50 podcasts in the land as determined by you, the podcast fans. From true crime, society and culture, self-help, health and fitness, science, and every podcast category in between. The Hot 50 Countdown is here.
And don't forget to vote for BK on the Air as one of your favorite podcasts at podcastmagazine.com.
I'm sorry, Earth is closed today.
You better pack it up and get out of here.
Get lost, Squidward.
Oh, why is it whenever I'm having fun, it's wrong?
Welcome back, everybody, to, I was going to say Waking Up with Alan, but it's not. It's BK on the Air. I am not BK. I am Alan Sanders, filling in for the vacationing BK. And this is that time where we get caught up with Pat McCormick with the golden rage of television.
Greetings, fellow classic TV fans. Many of you know that the late, great James Garner played the classic TV character known as the gunslinging gambler Brett Maverick. And if you recall, the Mavericks were a sizable family, with Jack Kelly as Bart Maverick, Robert Colbert as Brent Maverick, and 007 himself, Roger Moore, as Cousin Bo Maverick. The show had an impressive list of classic TV guest stars, too. Just to name a few, there was Buddy Ebsen, Alan Hale Jr., Mike Connors, Don Wells, and Adam West. rest. The legendary actor Robert Redford also appeared in an episode named The Iron Hand. In an interesting twist, Maverick's creator Roy Huggins claims that there was an episode titled Shady Deal at Sunny Acres, which he contends was directly restaged for the first half of a Best Picture Academy Award-winning movie, one that just so happened to star Robert Redford and his partner in crime, Paul Newman. It was called The Sting. So clearly, the influence of Maverick was a safe bet. For BK on the Air, this is Pat McCormick from the Golden Rage of TV.
Maverick. Starring James Garner and Jack Kelly. Produced by Warner Brothers.
You want to hear something that BK shared? Maybe he shared it with you, but when he shared it with me, I actually had to go look it up because I'm like, no, this is one I do not believe. I said, you are full of it. The cast of Friends right now, today, is older than the cast of Golden Girls when Golden Girls launched.
That is, oh, that's just heartbreaking. I don't know what to.
So apparently we all do age.
Yeah, eventually. And one day they will too, because they all still look great.
Oh, I can't believe that.
Unbelievable.
When I heard that, I didn't believe it. I did not at all. I mean, in my head, it's not that many years ago. Like I said, like a decade ago. But no, it was the 90s.
Yeah, yeah.
Now we're in 2022.
Yeah. And we were in school together.
Right.
When Friends came out. It's like, wait a minute.
Right.
I got to go to Dr. Gentile's class. So. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like.
I got lines to memorize. We got a play to put on. That's crazy, isn't it?
God, that was all Friends.
I think that's why BK's show hits the chord with the right age group, the Gen Xers and that surrounding kind of a few years before and a few years after, because we're hearkening back to these things that resonate with us still to this day.
Right, right.
And it's bananas to me to think about, like, when I think about Back to the Future, the movie.
Yeah.
You know, he only went 30 years back.
Don't do this.
Okay. Look at how different it was from 85 to 55.
Oh, yeah.
Now, we're in 2022. Do you think if you went back to 1992, it would feel that stark of a difference?
Oh, gosh.
Because the internet was growing at that point. Mm-hmm. Not everybody had it, but it was there. You were probably dialing up.
Right.
You didn't have smartphones, but the music hasn't been so radically different.
True. This is very true.
So, I mean, if you were to and I brought this up before, but I'm going to ask you, if we remake, because let's face it, Hollywood just loves remaking.
Right.
Let's reboot Back to the Future. How far back do you have to go for it to be jarring for the audience? Because 30 years in 1985, that was a long time because of how much changed.
They'd have to keep using 1950.
Don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I was talking to my daughter, actually, because I got on a big Buddy Holly kick this week. Don't know why, it's no anniversary or anything, but I was really just a big fan. But his music and what he talked about, you know, your first kiss, you know, this, I mean, getting together is very, the lyrics for the thing back at the time was so more innocent. I can't repeat some of the lyrics today that they had. It's just how much the world has changed. And just, and that's my wife's theory on relationships and how they used to be more, they seem to be, you know, more... well, you know, better and more honest and that kind of. And today it's like, you know,
more wholesome. Is that the word you're looking
for?
That's
what I'm looking for. Yes,
it's a little more wholesome.
Yes. If only I had a book with lots of words that showed different meanings.
If there was only a collection, a book that had a collection of similar meanings
exactly.
But different spellings.
I don't know.
What's another word for that?
Do they even have those anymore?
Yeah, online.
I see. Okay.
I actually have downloaded the dictionary.com app, and then you select the tab whether you want the thesaurus or the dictionary.
I actually do have I think I bought my last dictionary and thesaurus couple, like, about, I want to say, within 20 years. Yeah. It was ridiculous. We already have the internet. I know, I'm old.
When's the last time you had somebody going door-to-door selling their Encyclopedia Britannica? Or the Funk and Wagnalls. What library isn't complete without your Funk and Wagnalls?
Somebody had to tell me what that was, because I think BK showed it to me on...
Honestly, you had never heard of that?
I had never heard
You're
of that.
You're in the same age range as me, dude.
Yeah, okay. Well, we had Webster's. That's all I knew.
That's the dictionary. Yeah. Was there a Webster's Encyclopedia?
Oh, no. No, we had the... hang on. We had Britannica. Britannica's the only one
Encyclopedia
I
Britannica.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I just remember my mom thought that was the greatest thing she could invest for us, and they had this special where you could get the first or I think it was the first four or five letters, you know, because of Brooke, A, B, C, D, mm-hmm. whatever, the yep. first few letters at once, and then they would send you one a month so you could slowly build your encyclopedia library. And that's where I used to go for all my book reports.
Of course. And just barely plagiarize. Right, exactly.
What do you mean just barely? You know what's crazy about today, though? I will say this. Kids that try to get away with plagiarism, you're fooling yourselves. Because teachers, if you write a line that they're like, there's no way this kid in my class knows how to use this word in this context.
Yep.
All they'll do is put the first few words into a search engine,
yep.
and it will find the article
yep.
you stole.
Yep.
So I do not envy the kids today when it comes to writing papers.
It was so much easier back then.
Now, I grew up I grew up under a Catholic mom who'd been raised by nuns.
Oh.
The idea of cheating, lying, doing anything
right.
was a no-no.
Oh, wow.
So I grew up learning how to write on my own.
Well, my dad was a GBI, so I got away with nothing as well. He put me in jail.
You're not
for
like Walt. His right. dad's FBI, and so Walt like broke every crime in the world.
No, I knew I'm not. He put us in a holding cell. Let me say, me and my brother.
Did he really?
He did. Yeah, just for he said, hey, y'all
like
stay
overnight.
Here. No, I'm sure there were days. Yeah, so I knew then. I didn't. And that what they didn't have, they didn't have like you know Otis or anybody in there. What from Andy Griffith for. People don't know what that is, but...
I was like, wait a minute, Otis?
What's an Otis?
See, I got left with Bubba. That's different.
We didn't have anybody in there, but still, I did not want to be in the prison.
Yeah, so I learned very early on, I didn't need to go to prison for anything to realize I'm not cut out for prison life.
I'm not.
You know, there's some things I just know. I wasn't going to be a football player, I'm not a star athlete, and I don't belong in prison.
Exactly. And I'm no looker either, but I'm pretty.
I'm 5'8". It doesn't matter. Someone's gonna have me as theirs, and I'm like, I don't want that.
You for a carton of cigarettes, right?
You got some honey buns. I do not need that at all.
No.
I learned very early on, if I don't want to become a prisoner, I should do things that don't put me in prison. I should probably ride the straight and narrow. While we're having fun going nostalgic, do you remember, did you ever see either in the theater, Beverly Hills Cop?
Oh, yeah.
Like that was filmed in Detroit where I grew up, like in that whole area. Like, well, I didn't grow up in 8 Mile, but in that first area. I knew exactly where they were driving all around downtown with stolen cigarettes,
right,
and he's
right.
just like hanging onto the truck.
Oh yeah.
Have you? You know, I've known that this is something Eddie Murphy's wanted to do for a while. But do you know they are finally working on a sequel to
because
they did the third one, and the third one was terrible.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
one and two are great.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Third one, I was like, did you guys forget what you were doing?
Right.
Much like She-Hulk, did you forget what you guys had done? But according to this, the upcoming Beverly Hills Cop sequel is actually going to return Judge Reinhold, John Ashton, and Paul Reiser, as well as Bronson Pinchot.
Oh, wow.
So, like, as many of the people are still alive that were in the very first movie.
Right.
They're trying to make sure that for the whole nostalgia of it, they're going to bring all these characters back.
That's awesome. That's cool. I'll see it. Now, that goes back to that. I remember the language in that was so shocking to me.
was Eddie Murphy?
Well, yeah, you know, I mean, kind of, yeah. But, I mean, I just hurt my soul a little bit to go and watch. It took a few years for it to,
Now, if you go watch it today, you know, you're
just,
like,
it's
tame.
Standard talk. Yeah. It's kindergarten.
Like, come on, I watch Game of Thrones now. I got a room full of naked people, and that's considered mainstream entertainment.
Yeah. That's what it is.
Besides the maiming and the swords and the butchery and the debauchery. I mean,
exactly.
Hey, it's considered mainstream.
Oh, yeah. This is ridiculous where we've come.
What I loved about Beverly Hills Cop, because it was a buddy cop movie in a strange way, but from a completely different perspective. Mm. And this is when I thought Hollywood. I think maybe that's why I love the movies of the 80s so much. I felt like they were writing original stories.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah.
You know, this idea of a street cop who's streetwise, maybe knows how to bend the rules, and then goes to this lily white, we do things our way here.
Right.
It's like, oh, we do things our way here. You know, it's like, I love to see that. And then eventually realizing that the guys that wanted to get the bad guy were like, you know what, maybe we can meet somewhere in the middle. And Axel Foley goes, you know what, maybe I need to be a little more focused on what I should be doing and not just playing by the seat of my pants.
Exactly.
And these other guys are like, you know what, sometimes when we're so straight-laced, we might be letting the bad guys get away.
Yes.
I thought that was the greatest part of that.
It's great relationships, how they met together in somewhere in the middle, like you said. It's
Well, folks, we're at the bottom of the first hour here. We're going to have to take another break. We've got a GNN update coming your way, which BK probably edits out anyway. So the space you're hearing with other things is normally, if you're listening live, is news. But we'll be back with more of BK on the air.
Recon 1, I appreciate your concern, but I'd appreciate it all the more if next time you'd refrain from interfering in a directorate training mission.
What? If you call that interfering, there's something wrong with your fucking Wagnalls.
I don't know what you mean by that, but how'd you like to repeat that in the flight hangar?
I'd love to.
To understand the nature of life has been our quest from the beginning of time. A search full of curiosity, discovery, invention, genius, adventure. Today, your family can share this heritage in a remarkable new book, The Random House Encyclopedia. One volume of the world's basic knowledge, with thousands of color illustrations to illuminate the depth of our learning from the creation until today. The new Random House Encyclopedia. Come see it wherever books are sold.
The DeLorean. Gull-wing doors rise effortlessly, beckoning you inside. The sleek, stainless steel DeLorean. Beautifully crafted for long life, the DeLorean is one of the most awaited automobiles in automotive history. Drive the DeLorean. Live the dream today.
When it comes to shows about movies and comic books, heroes and crazy news, I tune into BK on the Air from 10 to noon Saturdays.
All right. Well, I got to figure out. It's time that we, the audience of the news, the weird, the strange, and the bizarre, and I didn't print this out, so I can't go back and forth, but you can comment on them as we go through.
I will comment.
I, of course, have the first news. Have you been to a water park that's got a lazy river?
Yes.
Well, one in Illinois apparently had a visitor.
Oh.
An Illinois water park marked the end of summer by having one last visitor float up the lazy river, an alligator.
Oh, Lordy.
Yes, according to this, the Scoville Zoo brought G, a 39-year-old alligator, to Splash Cove in Decatur to officially become the last visitor in the park to float the lazy river.
Wow.
It was a media event, kind of put a little spotlight on the zoo and a little spotlight on the water park. But Splash Cove officials said that the last human visitors were at the park several weeks ago, allowing chlorine to naturally burn off the water before it becomes safe for the reptile to swim.
Wow. Big or small, doesn't matter. It could be a one-foot alligator. I'd be out of there.
You'd be out of there?
Yeah. I was chased by a two-foot shark screaming like a manly woman running out of the lake.
Wait a minute.
Out of the river.
How does one become a manly woman?
Just go with it. I've only had one cup of coffee today. Get out.
Were you really chased by a shark?
Yeah.
How were you chased by a two-foot shark?
Okay,
do you mean it was swimming in the water with you?
It was there first, obviously. So, but I was in its direction.
You mean it didn't hop out and then walk back in?
Yeah, I would chase out that guy.
You said that you're lying on the beach, and Johnny's like, I don't like that guy in my water. But seriously.
I was on a sandbar, and I walked out to the sandbar. Of course, I had to get in like 6 feet of water to walk up to the sandbar about 20 feet out in the ocean. And then I see the fin, and it's coming in my direction. So I don't know if he was just swimming and just did, or if, to me, it was headed in my direction, so it was chasing me in my mind. So I treaded water as best I could.
See, for me, I would have been like, oh, that's so cool. I would have actually... Now, unless he bit me, and then I'd be like, okay, cool is no longer in my story.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The teeth, whether it's on a one-foot shark or a 20-foot shark, I don't care. That hurts. So I just didn't want that to happen during the...
But most of the sharks, let's face it, if you saw a drone shot above where you're swimming on the coastline, you'd probably never go in the water.
Probably not. Probably.
But they're all around you. They are all around.
All right. Well, it's at least one an alligator.
You just didn't want to see it.
Right. I didn't want
to
come in.
You're okay being next to it as long as you don't see it.
Yeah, pretty good. Yeah, I'm all right. But he was headed my way. So.
he was headed right.
Stay on target.
Stay. All right. I got the next news. I know BK likes these kind of stories, so I went with a Guinness World Record story. I didn't know if you heard this one, but, everything's bigger in Texas, right? Texas does big things. Well, volunteers with a Texas charity broke a Guinness World Record when they assembled 10,852 sandwiches and placed them in a line.
Oh, wow.
10,852 individual sandwiches. The Tango Charities broke the Guinness World Record for the longest line of sandwiches when volunteers gathered at the Texas Live Avenue in Arlington and made the 10,852 sandwiches and then assembled them into a line. The previous record had been 8,000, which was set in South Africa back in 2018.
Wow, that's...
Yeah, according to the charity group, said the event may have also broken record for the most sandwiches assembled in an hour and the most people making sandwiches simultaneously. Tango Charities officials said the sandwiches made in the attempt would then be distributed to partner charities in the area. That's kind of cool.
That's cool.
I like the Guinness records where they're doing something like that, like they're making food, but the whole point is to then give the food away, give it to people who need it. Yeah. The ones I can't do are like the ones like, I tried to figure out how to eat 75 marshmallows in under 60 seconds. I'm like, okay. What does that really do and benefit the world? Well, yeah. I'm the only one who can do it.
I haven't cut my fingernails in 75 years. Why? Why?
Okay, those, there are things in the Guinness World Book of Records that I look at and I go, oh.
That's just lazy.
I got the next news. So this one happened in Georgia a couple of weeks ago, actually right here in Bartow County. But since it happens more than other places, let's go ahead and get into this. Florida highway got covered in Coors Light after a semi-tractor-trailer crash.
Oh.
Yeah. From Brooksville, Florida, a Florida highway had to temporarily close this past Wednesday after a semi-trailer carrying cases and cases of Coors Light crashed and then turned the roadway into a silver sea of beer cans.
Buford T. Justice was just turning over his grave.
Well, of course, isn't that what Smokey and the Bandit was all about?
Yep.
Had to get across the Mississippi because they didn't allow Coors on this side.
Bizarre today. It's thinking that you can't take something as... No, you can't take New Coke across the Tennessee line or whatever. It's in Georgia.
What are you talking about? That's across the river. Them folks over there get to drink Coors. We got that's Bud over here.
Crazy. You can't take one thing. I just thought that was bizarre back then.
I thought it was just a make-believe thing for the movie when I was a kid, because I saw it when I was like maybe six or seven. No, it came out in 77, so I was like seven when I saw it.
Right.
So I actually saw it in the movie theater.
Right. Oh, yeah.
My dad probably didn't realize the language that was in it. I didn't even realize the language. I was just like, I was raised with a military guy, and I watched Patton when I was a kid. So, that's just how I thought people talked.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I got notes sent home from school.
We had the soundtrack. We got to Florida, what was it, 7-8 hour trip? We got there from here to Orlando in about 2.5 hours. Listen to Eastbound and Down. So you put that on, you'll get anywhere you need to fast.
Get there quickly. I loved Smokey and the Bandit, but the whole idea of them having to steal cases of Coors to bring to the two guys. What were the names?
Enos Burdett.
Yeah.
Big and Little Enos Burdett.
Yeah, Big and Little Enos. I have not seen that movie in a long time. I need to go back and rewatch it. The funniest thing is I had the copy that I recorded from TV, and so I thought that those were the real words, having forgotten what the real words were, and it's almost worth having both because the overdub is so funny.
So
it's
horrible.
As funny as the real words left in. But I know BK's done this before. The guy that did the voice for Fred Flintstone had to come in and do those voiceovers for Jackie Gleason. So it's not even Jackie Gleason doing an alternative version of his own words.
That's just what made it so bad, because I knew. I had a pretty good ear for things.
Really? Was he a bank robber?
Book blowing.
Huh? Bank robbing his baby stuff alongside of what this dude is doing.
That's not even him.
It's close, and if you didn't know, if you're not paying active attention, but you're like, the mouth doesn't match.
No, why didn't they get the guy who did the mice on the honeymooners in the Bugs Bunny episode? That sounded more like Jackie Gleason.
Isn't that the guy that plays Fred Flintstone?
Is that not him? I don't know, because it sounded more like Jackie Gleason on the cartoons.
No, I don't know.
You're a metal case. Yeah, I mean, it sounded a lot more like him than the
Oh my gosh, we're already at.
Are we having too much fun here?
We're having a great time. Well, anyway, I'll just tell you this: the multi-vehicle crash occurred after 6 a.m. Nothing like morning rush hour in the southbound lanes of I-75, about 30 miles north of Tampa. So I-75 is a beer run. We had beer all smashed up here in Bartow County a couple of weeks ago that closed the interstate down, and then here this just past Wednesday down in Florida, just a little north of Tampa. All right, we'll be right back with more BK in the Air.
Thank you, nice lady.
Sure thing.
After these messages, we'll be right back.
See you, Superman. Go, Wonder Woman.
Holy kryptonite.
You can follow the adventures of these superhero characters in four new Superheroes mini comic books, one in each specially marked box of Post Fruity and Cocoa Pebbles Rice cereal.
Watch me trick Fred out of his pebbles. Fred, want to learn yoga?
Sure.
Okay, now close your eyes.
Barney, my pebbles!
Yes, I double-crossed you, Fred.
Post Fruity and Cocoa Pebble cereal, delicious part of a nutritious breakfast.
I've never seen 10,000 tapes in one store.
There's so much kid stuff.
And I can keep them for 3 evenings.
Now this is a video store.
Ordinary video stores don't even come close to Blockbuster Video. You've just got to see it to know what we mean.
Wow. Wow.
Wow. What a difference. Blockbuster Video.
Come discover the Blockbuster difference. Wow.
Yeah, baby. Yeah.
Oh, welcome back, everybody. BK on the air. I'm Alan Sanders filling in. We've got Brian Gwynn, who's also here. You know, it's not just because we have amazing synergy. We actually do know each other. We went to college together.
We went to school together, yeah. Did our first plays together.
Yeah, we've been tight on stage.
We're tights together.
Wait a minute. Wait. What's going one line too far.
That's how
we're which is usually what my wife says about me when I get into a crowd. She goes, why do you always have to push it one thing too far? Everybody was fine being uncomfortable, and then all of a sudden you go, you think you're uncomfortable now? Hold on. Hold my beer.
Have you met me? It's right.
I find myself saying that to her an awful lot. I was like, I attracted you at some point, and I don't think I've changed. She goes, yeah, well, before, I didn't have to go home with you. Now I live with you. Like, people realize you're part of me, and now I'm embarrassed. I'm like, wait a minute. What? How does that happen? I know we got another news flash. We got a couple of news flashes. How does this happen? Now, this is a marriage thing. I need to understand this. We're out with some friends, you know, two or three other couples. And then the guy, another person, not affiliated with my family, says a goofball, off-the-wall, like mentally deficient thing. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Everyone's cracking up. My wife's cracking up. I come home and I say, honey, you tell me I'm not allowed to say that. And you laughed at him. She goes, but I don't go home with him. Like, that's not fair to me. But does that happen to you? Has that happened?
Okay, so when I was asked to come on the show, I'm always afraid I'm going to say something really dumb, and you're getting into
a
topic.
Are you male or female? Because if you're a male, you are guaranteed to say something dumb.
I am, but you're getting into marriage topic, and I'm not going to go into say something dumb. I love my wife. Honey, your hair looked really great today.
Okay, I get it. We know who's in charge in the Gwynn household.
Yes, she knows.
She's like, I can't say anything. I don't want to come home and get grounded. You, sir, go to your room. I can't believe you said that on the air. Do you know how many people were listening? Yes, tens of listeners were on the
air. That's right. There's at least a dozen people out there very angry with me right now. No, she doesn't listen to the show. We're safe.
My wife, I think you've heard me and BK talk about this, but his wife has the exact same, like, superpower. Mm-hmm. Like, her spidey sense is, because she never, never listens to me. I'm on the air in so many places, and she's like, did you have a good show? I'm like, did you listen? No. My family, I walk around, you come to my house, like, what's that smell? It's like, oh, it's disappointment. There is no support. But she's got the spidey sense. I could have had 7,000 hours of broadcast content, never once mentioned her. All of a sudden, it's like something happens. Like, oh, let me tell you about what my wife said. That's when she's decided,
that's the show.
I'm in the car. I'm heading to the fall festival. I decide, well, I'll just tune in. And of course, for her, so I hear you talk about me all the time. Right, honey. You're the only subject I bring up day after day. But then, I can't win for losing. So I've just given up.
I have heard these stories. I have heard this. Y'all have that. And then the Mrs. BK. I actually heard the story. BK brought up a story about Mrs. BK. And then I went to visit them. And then it was brought up. And it's like, honey, do you ever listen to my shows? Well, no. I mean, not all the time. But I was listening at that very moment. It's like, well, yeah, you were. So.
It's so funny. It's a superpower. She just knows.
I think Clooney said it in Three Kings. Is that right? Was it a movie?
Well, there was a movie, Three Kings, with George Clooney.
So he's talking to his troops, and he says, let me tell you how this works. So with me and my secondhand man, we're like a marriage. It's like the wife runs the household. I'm the head of the household. I don't really put my foot down a lot, but she does. But when I am like, and I do bring up something like, and she is very, you know what, and it makes her think. We'll talk, and she'll be like, "Yeah, you're wrong," or "I really want to do this," or "No, yeah." But
what's that like?
Well, that's another show.
Okay, you know we're almost out of time anyway. We're at the top of the hour. We've got more coming your way. More of this wonderful radio stuff, the stuff that you're going to learn to be a better human being just by listening. You'll say to yourself, I'm not quite as messed up as those two.
That's right.
I always say this, you know, you're never truly useless. You can always serve as a bad example.
Exactly.
So there we are.
Here we are. Another hour, at least.
All right, so we've got more coming your way. I have a couple more news flashes. I may just work them in as just news stories. But BK actually sent me a few things. The Hollywood sign is getting a 100th birthday makeover. That's kind of cool. We're going to talk a little bit about that. Mel Gibson sharing an idea for a Lethal Weapon 5 script and when it might start filming. We also have a couple of other things out there. And you know what? With me and Brian in here, we may not even get to even those stories. So I'm maybe just teasing you, and you're like, wait, we'll see what happens. You're listening to BK on the Air right here on AM 1450, FM 100.3, WBHF Cartersville.
We will return after these messages.
If you can pick bristle blocks up, you can put them together. And if you can put bristle blocks together, you can build all kinds of interesting things. Put any two bristle blocks together any which way, and they'll stay. Then you can pull them apart and see what else you can make.
What is that?
It's you, Daddy!
Bristle blocks at 806 from Play School, a Milton Bradley company.
I'm Gil Gerard. I'll be starring this fall as Buck Rogers in the 25th Century. From the moment I arrived in the 25th Century, everybody made me feel right at home. There were nights when I would just marvel at all the mysterious heavenly bodies. Well, here's to the future.
And now it's time for Reflections with Brother Gold.
And now, a composition by Styx. Give me a job. Give me security. Give me a chance to survive. I'm just a person in the unemployment line. But I got the power, and I got the will. I'm not a charity case. I say long nights be just what I am. Make me an offer that I can't refuse. This is my last time in the unemployment line.
Stand by to receive our transmission.
Oh my gosh, 1 hour done and in the books, and we're already on to hour number two? Who does number two work for? Apparently for free, because here we are.
Here we are.
Welcome, everybody, to BK on the Air. BK on vacation. It's I enjoy the fact that BK trusts me with his show, like I trust him with mine. And so he filled in for me a couple of Saturdays in August when we were on a family vacation. And so I get to do him the same favor back. And it's such a good time here in the studios of WBHF. Brian Gwynn filling in as well. So thanks for being here.
Hey, thanks for having me.
You know, we teased She-Hulk a couple of times. We got into talking about our wives. I don't want to, and I purposely didn't segue to She-Hulk because I don't want our wives to go, is that how you went onto this? Because I wanted to have a complete break. Okay.
That's right. Right.
Is there a worse Marvel Cinematic small screen series so far than She-Hulk?
Okay, I'm going to have to say, and I'm generally nice about everything and everybody, but it's
you are. You're
it's getting hard to watch. I'm sorry, but I try to give everybody the benefit of the doubt, but this is getting hard.
Now, I apparently am part of the Opus Dei. I can self-flagellate with the best of them. I feel like it's my duty to watch this to stay on top of it.
Is that what smells in here? Just kidding. Is that what you meant? It's a,
via drippings with goo. I couldn't even get through episode 6 last night.
Oh, goodness.
I said, I have to be up. I got 5 hours of broadcast. I got to go home after, take care of the dogs, do some things around the house, pick up my wife from the airport because she'd been gone for a couple of days. I'm going to go to bed.
Yeah. So we talked earlier, and you were mentioning the twerking. episodes.
That was episode third. Three. That was episode three. That was the post credit sequence.
Okay, so then
some people may not have known that that was in there.
Right. I apparently have missed the last three episodes. So my mental brain is telling me don't watch this anymore. Or I'm like,
there are better things to stream right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Cobblers Are Us, I think, was a good show. I think that was on that day. Even the Golden Girls Marathon was...
No, that would be really good. I'd watch the Golden Girls.
Over
She-Hulk, yes.
I because I love the actors and actors. The stories that they're doing and what they're doing to the characters. I'm tired of them being silly and funny. It's like, I want them to get back to, you know...
I started noticing this about... maybe 15 or 20 years ago when my kids were kind of hooked into the Disney sitcoms and some of the Nickelodeon sitcoms, it became cool to make dads look incompetent and stupid for the sake of the joke.
Yes.
You know, when I grew up, I had Leave It to Beaver. I had, you know, the Brady Bunch. I had, you know, Mr. Brady, who would be giving you kind of life lessons. And even if he did something a little silly or said like a dad joke,
right,
it wasn't at the expense of like, the only way we can make the kids look smart is we have to make the parents look like incompetent boobs.
Right, yeah.
I don't know when that changed. Mm-hmm. Why? I get you want a strong female character. That's cool. Mm-hmm. I got four daughters and a wife. I am way outnumbered in my own household, okay? Okay, I love having strong female characters. Ellen Ripley may be one of my favorite characters of all time in a franchise. I think you can have great, strong female characters. But you look at the story of, let's say, Alien.
Mm-hmm.
It's an equal among men. The men aren't relegated to stupidity to make her look strong and smart.
Right.
You look at Aliens. You've got these Marines who are used to being in combat. They didn't act like they were an F troop. They looked like they were a combat troop that were dealing with this... They had no idea what they were going up against.
Right, exactly. They weren't silly or foolish or that kind of thing. And we talked about this earlier. The men they had strong opinions as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then they both had to learn how to work together on it.
They complimented each other.
Exactly. They weren't. One wasn't stupid. It's to make the other look smart. Yes.
And it's the same thing. I don't want to see a female character written down to being like, where's the makeup aisle?
You know? I love the smart, strong women.
Right.
I do. I think it's great.
I think what they're doing and the error they've made with She-Hulk is the same thing they've done with the kids' comedies. It's like the kids that grew up watching these comedies are now writing the shows.
Mm-hmm.
And like, well, that's all they know. So the only way we can make a strong, strong female is let's make all the men dumb.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't like that. Let's go to the phones and say, good morning. You're on the air. BK on the air. Who's this?
This is Bart.
Hey, Bart. What's up?
I kind of think it started with Married with Children.
Maybe. You
know, Simpsons.
That really kind of was, I think, as far as the early transition into the father figure, you know, and there were some cartoons and stuff that did that. But I think really as far as, you know, real actresses and actors on the screen. And, of course, you see, I'm old school because I said actress. But I think that's where it started.
You know, you may have a point. An edgy show that was just being almost satirical became the benchmark for like, oh, well, that worked. Maybe we should always make the dad a goofball.
Simpsons kind of did the same thing. See, I remember like Brady Bunch who was the other one? The Leave It to Beaver. I always took it, yes, the dad was head of the household stuff, but the parents tend to work together.
Right.
And I never saw the mother weaker than the father, but I never saw, you know, I never saw that in this. And that's kind of what I carried on into my family, I hope.
Right.
So
that's a good point, Bart.
Well, you guys, I'm doing great. You guys keep this up, and BK won't even come back.
We've locked the doors.
Well, as long as you're enjoying what you're listening, that's all I care about.
We miss him.
All right.
See you, buddy.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. By the way, that phone number is 770-386-1450. If anything we're talking about, and whether it's you just want to say, that was great, or you guys are terrible. Well, if you say you guys are terrible, I'll probably hang up on you. But anyway, if you want to call in, that's certainly your prerogative, 770-386-1450, the phone number. We're almost out of break, so we'll just continue. We'll close out at this. I think what you just said was perfect. What I'd like to see is where a mom and a dad work together. Can you have an episode where mom does something goofy and that's what's funny because she got caught up in the moment of something like the first prom and thinks it's her prom moms will do that.
Yeah.
But you don't have to write completely unself-aware characters making them so lowly, so ridiculous, such buffoons that, of course, the other character is going to stand out because you've written such a weak counterpoint to them. Why wouldn't you want just an overall stronger story where both people contribute to the story?
Right, exactly.
And I think that's why Andor is such a good show.
Yeah, let's get to that.
I'm gonna set the table because we got a break coming up. After the Kenobi series, I was really worried that whatever is going on with the Marvel universe under Disney is now going to transpire because Kenobi started with promise, and I thought it was terrible by the end.
Oh, really?
It was so bad.
Oh, no. I'm sorry.
That last episode, I watched just because I knew it was the last episode, and I would have felt bad if I didn't at least watch how much worse it could get.
Yeah. Well, we can go into that a little later if we need to go to break, but I enjoyed it. I did.
I did the first three episodes. I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
I had some concerns at the end of the third, but then it got worse in the fourth.
Right.
Worse in the fifth. By the end, I was like, even BK had to agree with me. He wasn't as sour. I tend to be a little more vocal about it.
I'm such a huge fan of the character and Ewan McGregor. That's why.
We'll be back with more of BK on the Air.
Another happy landing.
Star Wars. You and your children loved it. Now the Earthlings at Kenner have asked my associate and me to present the Star Wars collection. Truly remarkable toys and games for your children. What are you so excited about now? My goodness, the Star Wars TIE Fighter and X-Wing Fighter. Now your children can relive our great space battles or collect our wonderful Star Wars companions with Kenner's Star Wars action figures. R2, it's a little you. Kenner's new radio-controlled R2-D2 anyone can command. Ah, the Star Wars land speeder that moves like it's floating. And here's Kenner's Death Star space station, four floors of action, a trash compactor too. Listen, R2, that's the Star Wars electronic laser battle, a game of speed, reflex, and reaction. These and other toys and games in Kenner's Star Wars collection are sold separately. Batteries are not included. May the Force be with you and your children.
Grow up on Toys R Us kid. They got a million toys and Toys R Us that I can play with. I don't want to grow up. I'm a Toys R Us kid. They got the best for so much less. You really flip your lid.
From bikes to trains to video games, it's the biggest toy store there is.
Gee whiz!
I don't want to grow up, because maybe if I did, I couldn't be a Toys R Us kid.
More games, more toys.
Oh, boy! I want to be a Toys R Us kid.
La 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 Luke! Luke, I am your father!
Aw, I've interrupted happy time.
That was from Star Wars.
I know.
Welcome back to BK on the Air. Much like with me and BK in studios, me and Brian, the show doesn't stop just because there's a break. The show's going on behind the scenes. It's just, you guys don't get to hear it. Thanks to Candy for listening. Always great having the audience out there. Appreciate the call during that break, and we are glad you are enjoying yourself. We're having a good time here, and hopefully if we're having a good time, it means you are too, and we appreciate you tuning in and listening. I dropped the topic, the tease of what I wanted to talk about, because I was worried about the small screen Star Wars stuff, because I've been worried about what the Marvel Cinematic Universe has been doing, especially underneath the Disney umbrella. I was not a fan of Kenobi at all.
Oh,
I started off as a fan of Kenobi, and folks who have listened to us talk about it as it went on live know that, and BK as well, had not to the degree. My severity is usually I'm more vocal about it. He's more tolerant of things that are just stupid.
Yeah, well, I raised my hand, but then I put it down. He said stupid.
He's like, in all seriousness, I get it. He has a little bit more of a wider range of tolerance than I do. If you mess something up in the universe you've created for me, if you've set some rules in place, any storyteller will tell you, you got to have some rules for your world, your universe. If it's got magic, if it's got monsters, there's still rules in that world.
Right.
And then just for the sake of twist, or just for the sake of shocking the audience, you break the rules, then you've lost me.
Yeah.
And I don't like that.
Yeah. I know what you're saying about Kenobi. And I don't want, I'm not downplaying the actress or whatever for the role that they gave her to do. She
it has nothing
well.
To do with the actors.
No,
it's once
it
again the writing.
Exactly. Yeah, and I love Kenobi. I love Ewan McGregor's Kenobi. I'd love to see a season two with a little better twist. I kind of saw this twist coming.
It would have been better to have a separate, complete separate story.
I just wanted him, but I didn't know. But I like it, and I'm tolerant of it because it's what they gave me, and I love the character so much, and I love the setting, and I love the world that I get to see. They just let me see more of that Star Wars world. That's the other part that I like.
Before we get to Andor, since I want to kind of use this as my... This is why I was really apprehensive, because we have established lore. You get run through with a lightsaber, you're not coming back.
Yet,
we have a character in Kenobi who's run through in a 6-episode series, not once, but twice.
That's right, yeah.
We establish that it takes, even at light speed, a certain amount of time to get from one side of the galaxy to the other.
Exactly.
Not instantaneous show up don't. We bring in a giant, massive piece of photon artillery to break a door down, and it's hammering the door, but then this Jedi gets ticked off that this person's on the other side, inserts her lightsaber, and the door opens in like 2 seconds.
Right, yeah.
When you're breaking the rules you've established for me, that's when I go, this is bad.
Yeah.
And that's what I felt happened. Nothing to do, Ewan McGregor was still the best part of Obi-Wan, of the Kenobi series.
Yeah.
But they took his character and they said, we're out of toilet paper. Can you bring me the Kenobi doll? That's what they did.
Awful.
It was terrible.
Yeah, yeah. I still appreciate what they gave us to the point, but it's like, I watched
you
it
are
over
gone,
and over again.
Anakin.
Yeah.
I've just beaten you. I see what you're capable of. I'm going to let you live.
Yeah. It's like...
no sense.
Did they ever mention a story where they met prior to these? Because normally there's a hint of this in the comics or some other story, but never. It was just a complete surprise. It was a pleasant surprise to see Hayden Christensen's return, because and how well liked he was for this, and he did a great job.
He did the job that he had to do with this material given to him.
But you're breaking the stories, so that's what's.
So let's get to Andor.
Yes.
I'll preface it with this.
You start first.
I have never been so let down with 3 back-to-back movies than I have been with the prequel trilogy to Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
Even when I've gone back, and I own them, because I keep telling myself, I'll figure out why they're supposed to be good.
Right.
Except for Ewan McGregor, and visually they're stunning.
Yes.
They are 3 bad movies. In a world that I love, let's be clear, I love Star Wars.
Yes.
When Rogue One came out, it was such a breath of fresh air and such a film that felt like it belonged in the Star Wars universe that for me and my wife, and she agrees, if we want to watch a Star Wars marathon, we're big about marathons in our house, that's the prequel. I don't watch 1, 2, and 3 anymore.
Right.
We watch Rogue One, and we immediately go to Star Wars, Empire, Return of the Jedi, and then we're done.
Yeah.
We don't even watch the post. I didn't mind Force Awakens, but I really did like the 8th one. What was it called? The Last Jedi.
The Last Jedi. Yeah,
I liked it. Everybody else hated it, which is why all of a sudden the Star Wars universe went to like crap, and everybody just hate. And so they tried to fix it in the last movie, and they just turned it into a goofy, stupid film. So whatever.
Right. Right.
Rogue One was my all-time favorite non-connected Star Wars movie, like set in that world. Dude, Andor is the Star Wars series I've wanted.
Oh, good. Okay, I was hoping that's where you're going.
I am blown away. I'm like, please, after 3 episodes, don't mess this up. You have established now a real story, a real world with real characters in Star Wars. Yeah. It doesn't feel stupid, and it doesn't feel like it's painted on a digital canvas.
Right, right. No, this is, I was confused when I first heard it that was coming out. So why him? Not that I didn't like his character. I mean, and I've loved this actor since Open Range. Was first my introduction to his. Give me his name.
So you put me on the spot.
Oh,
it
no.
is.
If only had a device.
It is Alejandro. No, it's not. It's a. Oh my gosh, what is it? I know it's the guy that plays Cassian Andor.
Yes, Cassian Andor. We'll get to it in a second. But
I know you
loved him since Open Range. Great. Part for him. I I'm not sure, for some reason, I thought he was French. I don't know why I thought his...
Spanish.
He is Spanish, yeah, but...
He's a very, very good actor. And if you watch Rogue One...
Diego Luna.
His sense in Rogue One of being someone who's been doing this his whole life,
mm-hmm.
and how it's sort of given him... He's now rough, and he doesn't necessarily believe in hope,
mm-hmm.
which is why the character of... wow, you think I would watch this enough that I would know her name. Not Rey. Rey is from the new movies.
Oh, why are we doing this?
This is what happens with Gen Xers when you start getting to a point. Your mouth goes faster than your ability to recall information.
It's sad.
Jyn Erso.
Jyn, yes.
When Jyn brings hope, he's like, there's no room for hope in the universe.
Yeah.
Like, I've been doing this since 6.
Yeah.
What I love is the people behind. And that's what made me have hope. When I heard it was the people who made Rogue One are doing the series.
Yeah.
And the guy, they interviewed him, and I watched the little 10-minute documentary. Have you watched that?
I saw that, yep.
Where he goes, we made him say this comment in the story that he's been fighting the Empire since he was 6.
Mm-hmm.
We felt like, there's a story to tell here. What happened to him at age 6?
Right.
And where did he go from there? I love it.
I was really blown away how, first of all, I love, and anytime they give me visual sighting of the Star Wars world, their background, all the sets and all this, I love that kind of stuff. But it's a great story. And now I forgot for... I think episode 2. This is Star Wars still,
right?
You know? Okay, there's a droid and there's some guys. I think they're Imperial troopers or something, or wannabes, or I don't know. But the story really carries you.
Mm-hmm.
Really puts you in a place that's very familiar with what you've known.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, they did such a good job with this.
It feels like you're in the Star Wars universe, but you realize it's a completely separate story from Luke and Leia. There are actually different people who live in this universe besides Luke, Leia, and Darth Vader.
Right.
And I love that. I've heard this, and I want to get your take on this before we head to the bottom of the hour, because a lot of people are going, it's too dark, and it's written only for adults. I was like, did you watch Empire Strikes Back?
Yeah. Did you see the difference between, Revenge of the Sith and Star Wars? It's a dark period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's dark.
I get the idea being, where's the teddy bears and where's the Yoda and where's the, you forget just because you watched it as a kid, you just assumed it was a kid's movie. No, Star Wars was always an adult movie that was allowed to that kids were allowed to watch because there wasn't gratuitous violence. Like, there were people dying, but you didn't see blood. You didn't see, gore.
Right.
And you didn't have any kind of, love scenes or anything like that. When I read this article that said, Star Wars has taken a dark turn into too much of an adult world. All I kept thinking was, did you not pay attention to what happened in Empire Strikes Back?
Right.
I mean, literally everything goes bad for everybody, including, we lose Han. We don't know if he's coming back.
Right.
Leia's now is going to be handed over. Luke, people are being tortured.
Yes.
How much darker do you get?
For crying out loud. Yeah, right. He loses a body part, for crying out loud. Yeah.
And it's like, a lot of people, and BK and I are eye to eye on this, of the original trilogy, the single best Star Wars movie is Empire Strikes Back.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Part of it is because they had to tell a bigger, darker adult story.
Mm-hmm.
They had the fairy tale to set the stage, and they had to go into more of a grittier story, and that's why we love it.
But they've hinted on this story for every movie. They've hinted towards it, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. They've hinted on how bad it was between this period,
right.
And now we're getting to see it. Okay, and you saw, I think when in Rogue One, Vader pops out. Spoilers. Okay, when Vader pops out and starts slashing people. That's the darkest I've ever seen this series go, and it's like there's more to it than that.
These right.
People suffered, and there's some realism to it. It's kind of like with Iron Man. Okay, yeah, you know what? That probably could happen. A guy rich who really is good with his hands, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Batman, a guy who really with the Dark Knight, a rich guy could go get trained.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, kind of could happen. I love it how they can actually make it kind of real.
I love the idea of seeing. Because there's no stormtroopers yet.
Yeah, right.
I like how we understand there's an empire, and they've got forces, but they're not in armor yet, unified, very fascist, like the Empire of Star Wars. We're going to get there.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, the lieutenant...
Yeah.
Man, is he good.
He's okay.
We obviously didn't cover everything we need to cover because we're at the break already. I want to talk more about, and we've only seen three episodes. They dropped three.
Yeah.
It's still going to be a weekly show. We'll be back with more BK on the Air.
Lighten up, Francis.
Oh. Otto? Where are you? Otto? Otto? Otto, you're on fire! R2-D2, you found a cigarette. Well, I don't think smoking is grown up at all. Because it's very dangerous. Smoking does dreadful things to your lungs and is very bad for your heart. Well, I know I don't have one, but humans do, and I think we should set a good example. Well done, R2. Oh, hello. You know smoking is bad for your health, and it isn't grown up at all. So please, don't smoke. R2, do you really think I don't have a heart?
You are the new American society, the movers and the shakers.
Hold on tight to your dream.
You are the new coffee generation.
Because coffee lets you calm yourself down and picks you up. Coffee gives you the serenity to dream it and the vitality to do it. No other drink does that like coffee.
Hold on tight to your dream.
Join the coffee achievers.
Do your best.
What's happening?
Yeah, I've got news stories, supposedly, that I'm going to get to. Welcome back, everybody. BK, BK on the air. I'm not BK. I'm filling in.
No shit, Sherlock.
For BK, who's on vacation, and it is a pleasure to be here with you. Brian Gwynn is in here. We're having a great time.
Good time.
If you can't tell, you know, you may not be, but we're having a grand old time. that's all that really matters to me. But, you know, I do think if I've always felt this. The shows I like listening to are the podcasts. When you hear people having a good time, and they're not telling inside jokes, we're like, I have no idea what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. When you know what they're talking about and they're having a good time, you can't help but just enjoy it. And so I'm hoping we're doing the same thing for the audience. We didn't stop talking about Andor the whole time. So I want to continue, and then I'll get to a couple of these news stories because, you know, BK went through the effort of actually creating some of these for me. Andor is not too adult to me. It's not Game of Thrones, okay? But it is adult people dealing with a world where the Empire is starting to continue to tighten. It's like Leia says, the more you tighten your fist, the more systems will slip through your fingers. Mm-hmm. We are seeing, and there was a line from one of the sergeants to the lieutenant, the officer I wanted to talk about, who said there are pockets fomenting. There are people who are not liking the Empire, and we have to squash them.
Yep. Very powerful line.
Those are adults in adult situations in an adult world dealing with real problems. Mm. They're not going to be goofballs. They're not going to be saying, they're not going to talk stupid. They're not going to be worrying about whether or not they can find, you know, a lollipop at the store.
Mm.
And so, of course, it's going to have an adult-centered storyline.
Yep.
I have no problem with that.
No. I mean, as we mentioned, the time between Revenge of the Sith and Star Wars, there's something happened because everything was bright and shiny in the first two or three episodes of the film, of the series, and then before they gave us anything else, Star Wars, and it just was bland and just kind of just plain, and the dress and even the town was just, you know, there's just not a lot of fashion and design to a lot of, but which was fantastic in the day, but now we know it's a dark period of time and the Emperor's taken over, and this is the story that This is how it got there, and this is how the changes happen. And I'm loving how they're opening these stories.
The set design, the costume design, the settings, the location, everything so far is spot on.
Oh yeah,
there is another. The guy who's playing the gung-ho lieutenant, I will tell you, we got a talk about great acting.
Oh, yeah,
when he's asked to deliver a motivational speech to the guys that are going after, they're going after Cassian. They figured out who it was. And then I'm like, I don't want to give anything away.
Right.
He gives a speech, and here's this guy who's Mr. Gung Ho, who has no idea how to motivate anybody, but he thinks he's all that, and it leads perfectly to him just standing there at the end of episode three, recognizing, I thought I was doing the good thing. Look what ended up happening.
Yeah,
I broke. First of all, he disobeyed orders.
Right,
but he thought he was justified.
Yes.
He believes that he's doing the right thing. And I could just, the wheels turning in that actor, like the performance being given of that character, I want to see what happens to him as much as I want to see what's going on with the other people.
Absolute serious conflict inside that guy. And he's pulling it off amazingly.
So good.
I mean, yeah, just... something I noticed, in, even Kenobi, when watching Ewan McGregor do what he's going through and watching his pain, and this, watching this actor, just what is going on? It's like, okay, what am I doing? Do I really, am I right about this?
Right.
And now it's like, do I need to question this? No. Am I, all right. And then, like you said, he didn't know how to motivate. All he knows is how to do what he's told to do.
Right.
Wow.
Which means he himself is flawed in that he thinks he's bigger and greater than he actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And when he has failures, he never expected to fail, because in your mind he thinks, "Well, I'm going to win."
Mm-hmm.
The realism of that is amazing.
Right. There was an article I read. My wife was actually telling me about the, where there's another character where people are not happy with it. But I'm thinking, I didn't read who it was, but I'm thinking people are not that crazy about him. Which, guess what? That means he's doing his job. He's not. He didn't sign on to be the likable one.
He's not the hero.
No, he's not. He's on the bad side of the
right.
Yeah. So,
but in his mind, the best villains are the ones who don't think they're villains.
Exactly. Yeah. And he is doing phenomenal.
Oh.
Yeah.
By the way, his superior officer, that British actor.
Yeah.
Talk about owning the entire scene.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
When he was explaining, here's what I think happened, and he's giving him the. Oh, I was like, that guy is so good.
Yep. I've seen him a lot of things. He was a great, I don't know, character actor. I've seen him play in character parts with a lot of shows. I like that guy.
So good. Folks, I'm two thumbs up right now. If you are worried about watching a Star Wars anything on the small screen, Andor, two thumbs up. Mm. It is well worth checking out. I told you about Mel Gibson. Let's get into this story quickly before we get to our final break, which is coming up in just a few minutes. Were you a fan of the Lethal Weapon series?
Oh, big fan, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I even liked 4.
Yeah.
I thought it was all right. I mean, they can't do the same thing every time.
Right.
You know, Jet Li, I thought, was fun in that. And, but they're talking about Mel Gibson has shared Lethal Weapon 5 script and then a possible film start, according to a story from Screen Rant. Here's an exclusive, the sub-headline. Director/star Mel Gibson shares a hopeful Lethal Weapon 5 update, teasing a really good screenplay and a potential filming window. After years of languishing in development hell, their words, not mine, Lethal Weapon 5 has gotten a hopeful update from Mel Gibson. The buddy cop action comedy franchise is considered one of the two big projects that helped launch Gibson into stardom, alongside his role playing Mad Max. Gibson starred in Lethal Weapon as Detective Martin Riggs, a narcotics detective with suicidal tendencies following the death of his wife, who is partnered with then-veteran homicide detective Roger Murtaugh and slowly breaks out of his shell with each new case they investigate. Though not the first in a genre, the original Lethal Weapon movie is largely considered to be what helped popularize the buddy cop formula, with its critical acclaim and box office success spawning a franchise including 3 sequels and a TV reboot with Damon Wayans and Clyne Crawford as Murtaugh and Riggs. Plans for a Lethal Weapon 5 have swirled for years, with original director Richard Donner's death nearly derailing the project until Gibson stepped up to direct on a script from Equalizer and The Magnificent Seven's Richard Wenk. Love The Equalizer. The rewrite of Magnificent Seven had some flaws, but it was still fun.
It was fun, yeah.
With nearly a year gone since it was confirmed Gibson would be taking over the director's chair, audiences are getting exciting news from the long-awaited Lethal Weapon 5 rumors. While speaking exclusively with Screen Rant to discuss the true crime thriller Bandit, Mel Gibson offered a hopeful Lethal Weapon 5 update. Though noting the recent shakeups at Warner Brothers following the Discovery merger has led to its delay, Gibson expressed confidence in getting the sequel off the ground and teased a potential filming start window for the project. Here's what he said, and I'll leave it at that because we're getting close to the break. It's coming along great. We've got a really good screenplay that I developed. Well, Donner developed it. Richard Donner, of course, developed it with Richard Wenk, and they had a really good template. I had the honor of sitting down after Richard passed away with the writer and doing a couple more drafts and trying to do it in the spirit of what we thought Donner might want, because I knew the guy so well. We tried to get that flavor, and we were pretty happy with what we came up with. The only delay is now with all the shakeup at Warner's, with Discovery coming in and the new boss, and they have to chop everyone else up and throw them away and get new people. It always takes time for these companies to regroup. So it's been a delay, but I'm pretty confident we'll get this one up on its feet, probably shoot it in the first quarter of the new year.
I hope that they pull it off. And that was one that you could definitely tell that sequels can be better. That was because I think 2 was almost better than the original.
2 was better than the original.
Yeah, that's my opinion. It was
And I thought 3 was a great end cap. I didn't know they were going to do a 4. Because adding the female interest to see Murtaugh, finally with somebody who can kind of hold her own with him.
Yep.
Not just a love interest like in the second movie.
Right.
But to have somebody who was like his equal.
You could match, yeah. Match him.
I mean, Rene Russo, first of all.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah.
Thor's mom.
You just need a moment. But, I mean, honestly, that was great. The fourth one definitely is the weakest of the three. But as a trilogy, initially, you could binge that as a trilogy. You could do a little movie marathon with the Lethal Weapon series.
Mm-hmm.
They're very good. I'd say the first two are more R-rated, whereas I think the third one was PG-13.
Yeah.
So be careful around the kids. But Lethal Weapon, it was such a good story.
Oh, yeah.
And great performances.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah.
I knew Mel Gibson because I loved Road Warrior.
Right.
I got introduced to Road Warrior and then Mad Max before I even saw Lethal Weapon. When I saw him play in Lethal Weapon, I was like, that guy's an actor.
Mm-hmm.
He may be an action movie. He might have a lot of great fights, but the pain on his face, the expression, he's an actor. And he's still one of my all-time favorites.
Yeah, The Bounty. That was where I saw. Yeah.
Oh, with the...
Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah,
that's where I saw. Yeah, but I'm glad he did that.
So look, you've got cast colonels out there outside the window. We got to take a quick break. We got one more segment coming your way. This is BK on the Air. BK's out. I'm Alan Sanders filling in. Brian Gwynn's in studios. Stick around.
Gun!
Raj, meet you, new partner.
If these two cops can stand each other.
Oh, I keep getting into trouble around you.
The bad guys don't stand a chance.
You haven't met anybody you didn't kill?
Well, I haven't killed you yet.
Mel Gibson, Danny Glover.
We better register you as a lethal weapon.
Lethal Weapon, rated R. Starts Friday, March 6th.
Who are you waiting for?
Ice Cream Jones.
A new ice cream cone cereal.
My name's Ice Cream Jones. I'm bringing the kids my ice cream cones. A crunchy new cereal for breakfast. The great taste of ice cream cones. Whoa!
I'll have vanilla.
Give me chocolate chip.
They look like little ice cream cones.
And taste like them. The crunchy part of this nutritious breakfast.
My name's Ice Cream Jones. With the great taste of ice cream cones.
New ice cream cone cereal.
Thankfully, I'm not BK. And he's definitely older than me. Not by much, but he is older than me. I can say that. I tell my wife that. You were only 4 months apart, but because her birthday's in July and mine's in November, right now I'm like, you're a year older than me. She was like, I'm 4 months older than you. I'm like, if somebody says, how old are you? Do you say you are 55 plus, or must be 51 plus 4 months? Or do you say you're 52? She goes, I'm 52. I'm like, what do I say? I don't say I'm almost 52. I say I'm 51.
I'm 52 and a half.
Do you say that?
Yeah, it's important to keep that half in there.
I don't ever. In fact, I'm looking forward to the 12th anniversary of my 40th birthday coming up.
Oh, nice. You too?
I like to say it that way. It's my 12th anniversary of my 40th birthday.
It's my 15th anniversary of my 29th birthday, so I can't do... I don't know. I think I know the math is wrong in there somewhere.
Probably.
No one's going to be quizzed.
All right. You know, we're talking about Lethal Weapon. I do have one more story I want to get to. And I didn't tease this story because there is a Hollywood sign is going to get a makeover. So let me do that very, very quickly because I try to, if I'm going to bring something up, I want to try to get to it. But the Hollywood sign, I didn't know this. You know, it used to be Hollywoodland.
Mm-hmm.
And then the land fell and left the Hollywood up. It's going to get a makeover, according to this story from this Los Angeles Magazine. The saucy old gal, which can you are allowed to say that today?
I don't know what.
I'm reading it. Which hasn't been refurbished since 2012 is getting a wash and paint job for the historic anniversary. The aging beauty is getting a facelift. It's coming up on its 100th anniversary, so get ready for a brand new, bright and shiny Hollywood sign if you're heading out.
Happy birthday!
Okay, happy birthday!
So are they going to change the sign design, too, or they're
just
going to clean it?
They're just cleaning it.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, make sure that it can withstand the next earthquake
and
fall over.
Oh, goodness.
So check out the trend in the stories we have today from Hollywood. We talked about Eddie Murphy talking about finally doing a Beverly Hills Cop 4. Mm. We just talked about Lethal Weapon 5. Where else could we go but now Mike Myers... wants to do an Austin Powers 4.
I knew it was going to come eventually. This is the first I've heard of it.
According to a story here that I have from Fox News, so you know it's got to be true. Sorry. For all my friends on the left who don't like Fox. Sometimes Fox News actually does entertainment news, too, like everybody else. Fox News, Mike Myers opened up about the possibility of a future film in the Austin Powers series, subtly teasing that fans could possibly expect the fourth film in the near future. Says, quote, "I don't know," the comedian actor said when asked a possible new installment in the beloved comedy franchise at a red carpet event for his new film, Amsterdam. Quote, "I'm going to put a big firm written maybe on that." So is this one of those clickbait stories that actually there's no sense that we're going to get a number
right,
four,
nothing.
But someone has to like get you to come to their website, so you write a clickbait headline? I don't know.
I've wondered if he's going to do another one. I kind of wanted to see it. We couldn't watch the third one. Something about it that grossed my wife out. I can't remember what it was. I think when he ate
his
skin.
Was it gold member?
Oh, yeah.
He's saving his skin? I put it in a box. It's good. I just chew it. It's good.
No.
I am your Faja. You're my what?
You're my Faja.
Faja. My Faja. I don't know what you're saying. I don't normally like really stupid movies, but for some reason, because it's based on James Bond and because Austin or Mike Myers is so gifted at so many characters, the Austin Powers series I have always loved.
They've cracked me up. Yeah, I remember going to see it for the first time with the group I worked with years and years ago. I don't remember laughing so hard in a movie in my life.
Just nonstop and quotable. You can always relive it. So, the quotability. Mm-hmm. The, being able to, like, with friends, to be able to sit down and go, yeah, remember that line, and then you relive. I mean, that's a skill of a movie.
Oh, yeah.
You have a classic on your hand.
So many lines still. I mean, how many people get stuck in traffic or trying to get a parking space that you're not referencing his little back and forth motion in the hallway on that little whatever? I mean, yeah.
Funny. And the play on James Bond.
Do y'all have that one?
James Earl Jones officially retires as Star Wars Darth Vader.
You
can run with that.
I didn't know if he had that or not, but it was. It looks like that he sent it to me yesterday. Looked like the story broke like an hour before he had sent it to me. So I thought he had passed, but no, he's still very much alive and he's retired.
Because James Earl Jones did the voice for the Vader even in Rogue One.
Mm-hmm.
And then I thought he also did it for Kenobi.
Kenobi, he did. Mm-hmm. He sure did. But I think they're going to use his, and I can't find it fast enough. But
well, they've probably digitized his library of voice to be able to create whatever they need to now.
Signed over the voice rights to Lucasfilm and Reese Speecher.
Yeah,
so
there you
they'll
go.
Be able to use, that's cool.
Well, it makes sense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I couldn't imagine anybody else trying to imitate.
You can't.
I mean, come close.
First of all,
there's a lot of gifted people out there who came really close, but it's just unmistakable.
I don't think anybody can do James Earl Jones.
No, I'm not even going to try. I'm not even going to imitate it.
No, you can't. There is only one James Earl Jones. But the whole thing, just getting back to Austin Powers, I mean, every time the whole 1 million. Okay. I mean, every time you talk about that, you bring your pinky.
When another
up.
Word million, 1 million comes up, everybody's pinky goes up automatically. It's just
the whole mini me. He's like spraying him with the little water bottle, like he's a like a feral cat.
Oh, that cat! Those cats just make me. These creep me out. That little. Mr. Bigglesworth.
Just solid, fun movies.
How many times have I had a bag of shh in right here with me when I'm trying to discipline my kids? No, shh, no, don't talk back. Shh, no, shh, no, shh, shh, shh. I got a whole bag of shh right here, so keep it down.
www.shh.com.org.
I'm going to have to go back and rewatch those.
See, here we are. I find myself quoting. So like when I know I should watch for the completion of something, but I'm assuming it's going to happen, I always go like, I am going to now leave him on an unnecessarily slow-moving device and not see to it that his end has been met, and walks out of the room. He's like, I have a gun upstairs. I'll do it right now. Like, but, I mean, that's the thing that I love is if you were a James Bond fan, if you understood all the references, you didn't have to, but if you did, it made it even funnier.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's, yeah. I can't. I'm gonna have to watch it again. You got me excited about watching.
That's the thing. My wife and I did that just recently. I said this. We'll wrap on this and see if you and your wife do this. If others do this, but we have certain franchises that we just dedicate to. At some point, once a year, we're gonna go through the franchise.
Do you have seasonal franchises? Yeah, you could only watch it during a certain time of year. Harry Potter, for some reason, we have to watch like into fall, winter. I don't know why, but
we'll do that anytime. But I will tell you, the tradition started. New Year's.
Mm-hmm.
Because you wake up New Year's Day having stayed up way too long New Year's night, for us anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, I don't feel like doing anything. I don't feel like going anywhere.
Yeah.
Let's put in Harry Potter and start the series.
Right.
And you could end up spending 12 hours straight watching as many as you can, and then you pick up the next day with whatever you have. But Harry Potter's one of them. Lord of the Rings, Extended Director's Cut is one of them.
Yes.
But the Austin Powers series.
Yeah, oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just one of those things. Where, now, that can be any time. It's not seasonal, but for us. And my wife is a big James Bond fan. She doesn't think of it as misogynistic or anything. She's like, it's a product of its time. I can kick back and watch a movie.
Right, exactly. Well put, a product of its time. Don't take offense to it now because it's something that happened 50 years ago that we can't do anything about and we weren't even alive, maybe. So,
right.
But yeah, but...
I want to rewrite history to make me comfortable today. That's not how it works.
I was talking to my daughter about that. So don't be one of those people that has to sit in a room full of puppies to make you feel better. Oh, I want to pet puppies. No, daughter, you're missing the point. Never, you know what? Forget it. Yeah.
Now, I will tell you, I'd rather be in a room full of puppies than people. I can tell you, I've reached that point in my life. The puppies aren't going to tick me off. The people do.
I can see.
I mean, the puppy can make me aggravated if it, like, wets on something or chews something. But I'm like, it's a puppy. I kind of forgive it. An adult should know better. When an adult chews up the pillow, I'm like, okay, come on.
Yeah.
You know better.
Yes. Yeah. We're dog sitting.
You've ruined my scenery. All right. So James Earl Jones has retired, but it signed over his voice.
Yeah, that's going to be really cool.
LucasArts, you may now... Can you imagine if somebody... You know some kid is trying to get in there like, let's get him to narrate like one of those like romance novels.
Right.
As Darth Vader. If we had access to that software, we could. Brian, thank you so much for being here. It's been fun.
Great. I can't wait to come back.
Well, anytime. Well, you got to ask BK. But anytime here, if I'm filling in, you can certainly join me because I enjoy the company and I think we had a great time. Folks, I think BK, I'm going to send this to him. I don't know when he'll get to it, but he may put this out as a podcast. I don't know. But if he does, great. If not, come on back next Saturday for another episode of BK on the Air.
Let's go have some fun. My wife's in New York and I got a Lion King residual check burning a hole in my pocket.